if you look at Russia and China, and the US for that matter, they have invested in missile technology and are reinvesting in missile technology, also having platforms with a large number of missiles on them. And Europeans lack that to a large extent.
I am here with Jeremy Stöhs, the Deputy Director of the Austrian Center for Intelligence, Propaganda and Security Studies, also called ACIPS. And we are discussing Jeremy's new report, How High the Future of European Naval Power and the High-End Challenge, that he wrote in cooperation with the Center for Military Studies at the University of Copenhagen. And Jeremy, in your report, you discuss a range of challenges for European navies, and you group them into what you call demand-side challenges and supply-side challenges. So what is actually the difference?
We discussed many challenges that European or naval forces in Europe and maritime forces in Europe face currently, perceived challenges. And we concluded, and I concluded, that there actually needs to be a difference between those that are largely set by the strategic environment, that are come out of the strategic environment, and those that are inherent to naval forces in general. And so that's the one side, the demand side. So the demand created by the strategic environment and great power competition. So large, powerful states, the US, China, Russia, being in strategic competition with each other, investing in high-end military capabilities and military capabilities in general, but in particular for the high-end fight, and that creates a demand. And we came up with three demand-side challenges, which is the proliferation of missiles and sensors. The second would be development of artificial intelligence and disruptive technologies, and the third would be then multi-domain operations and the challenges that arise from there. And the supply side challenges are those that are inherent, that are, however, because of the strategic environment, are worsened, are exacerbated by what is happening currently, but are general are challenges that all navies face.
Okay. If we go through the demand side challenges then first, I just think we could go through them one by one. You mentioned the first one is the proliferation of advanced missiles and sensors. So what is that challenge actually about?
It's not a new challenge. Missiles and sensors have been around for some time. And if you think back to the days of the Cold War, missiles were, present in naval thinking as well as in defense thinking all the time, being in intercontinental or anti-ship missiles, backfire bombers, Tomcats with their Phoenix missiles, the battle in the Atlantic, all of that. So that is not new. What is new is that after a period of relative a slow development in missile technology, a unipolar moment, the U.S. being coming out of the Cold War as the winner. Now we see the development for several years already, in particular in China and in Russia, of new missile technology linked to new sensor technology that make those systems much more lethal. And we don't want to overhype them on the one hand, because there is a hype about hypersonic missiles, for example, travel at Mach 8, Mach 10, and beyond that. But at the same time, we should not disregard this development as a very important development. And we just have to look back at the experience of the Falklands to see how lethal and how dangerous missiles can be. And one of the issues is, of course, sensors are becoming more capable. So targeting ships also further out via satellite systems, this is difficult, but it's becoming more likely and more possible. And that is especially because NATO forces, European navies, are built around big assets, large ships, large land hubs, units, airfields. That is very important to NATO and to the European states as well in their defense planning. those are becoming vulnerable to being attacked by long-range missiles as well.
It's interesting. I'm from Denmark, and here we have, I think, an interesting debate about how to equip our frigates in order to counter these missiles and the investments needed to purchase missiles that are going to defend the platform against such threats, hypersonic missiles, tactical ballistic missiles, things like that, and just the challenges of explaining to the politicians that we need to buy these missiles, not because they actually do something new for us, but in order to keep on being able to protect ourselves. It can be a difficult argument to make and just to keep up with this challenge.
And if I may add, that's an important point you make, keeping up. So how high is this level that small navies have to at least stay in the wake of those large navies, in particular of the US Navy, to be able to operate with this large navy if push comes to shove, to deter, but also to win the fight if that is necessary. And what I speak about in the study is actually a missile gap. If you look at Russia and China, and the US for that matter, they have invested in missile technology and are reinvesting in missile technology, also having platforms with a large number of missiles on them. And Europeans lack that to a large extent. A, because it's very expensive. Missiles are very expensive, and the Danish lawmakers will also definitely raise that point. But also because the threat perception was different in last decades. And, you know, laser technology is something, so high power laser technology is something we need to look into to defend against that, but also missile systems, and to close, at least to some extent, this missile gap that European navies are suffering.
The next demand side challenge you mentioned is artificial intelligence and autonomous weapon systems. So how is that a particular challenge, and how is it actually different from just development in missile technology?
Well, those are two broad terms anyway, artificial intelligence and disruptive technologies, autonomous weapons. The idea behind it is that those technologies can bring about a leap ahead in the effectiveness of conducting military operations, as was the case with networked operations, or network-centric operations in the late 80s, 1990s, and Desert Storm, for example, where the United States applied that. The issue with these technologies is they're also not necessarily new conceptually. Autonomous systems, we've been using them in the, or many navies have been using them in mine warfare, combat systems, already use those kinds of autonomous processes. The issue is that now through technology, it is possible to expand that realm and expand those systems. If we're talking about autonomous, unmanned, partially manned systems, be it UAVs, underwater gliders, and other such things, we really have both in using sensors as well as using them as weapons, kinetic systems. I think there's a huge potential there that is very difficult. There are a lot of ethical questions as well involved in that. But I just want to remind the viewers of Nagorno-Karabakh and the war between Armenia and Azerbaijan, where the drone technology and the suicide drones and also the ISR, the intelligence surveillance and reconnaissance, was used very effectively. And that's also will be used in the future in the maritime domain. So those are technologies we cannot overlook, where especially small navies could leverage to their advantage in the long run.
And finally, you discuss the operational challenges that come from multi-domain operations, and that this is a particular demand-side challenge. Why is multi-domain operations a particular challenge?
Yes, another buzzword. I admit that is being thrown around a lot, especially in the English-speaking world, but in defense in general, in defense speak, multi-domain operations more or less signifies military operations that take place across geographical boundaries and across the domains we mentioned. I think it was in video one. So air, land, and sea, space, electromagnetic spectrum, and the cyber domain. And all at the same time, very quickly, decisions have to be made. And that is how likely conflict will develop if it can't be deterred. And in this environment, it will be difficult for forces to survive and not be not become obsolete in minute one or second one if they're not able to at least provide a certain degree of capability in all those different domains. So through strategic competition, through great powers investing in high-end capabilities, multi-domain operations would likely be what we will see, what we'd see in actual war fighting. So we have to prepare for that. And going back to the area of artificial intelligence and autonomous systems, here those things come into play, those technologies come into play, and using and applying those technologies to make decisions faster, to provide the intelligence, the surveillance, the targeting data, because likely those fights will develop very quickly, and whoever shoots first usually also has the advantage. So having those reconnaissance capabilities through those technologies, having autonomous systems, and then being able to operate across those domains in multi-domain operations together for small states, together with friends and allies, that will be of critical importance.
So lots of demands and challenges. Thanks a lot, Jeremy.
Yes.